crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. Shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. The fear that held us now to him who is our peace, his final breath upon the cross is now alive in me. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King.
Good morning, good morning, guys. Welcome to Legacy Pointe Baptist Church. I'm glad you chose to join us this morning. It's a blessing that everyone's here today. We've got a great time of worship prepared for you guys. So let's start the morning off with a shout of praise. Amen. We've waited for this day. We've gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason, God. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing.
Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, look into the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing.
Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise.
Day that's to come, where we finally stand in the presence of Jesus, when we finally come home to be with our Father, when we can do, well, what can we do but just stand amazed? Sing this song with me. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. Sing that again.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned, unclean. Singing how
crowned in glory. His face I at last shall see. It will my joy to the ages to sing of his love for me. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful is my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Is my Savior's love for me. Amen, amen. You guys may be seated. We have a couple announcements for you this morning. I'm so glad you're here. God is good, amen. I want to say to our online audience, I'm glad you've chosen to join us this morning. It's always a blessing to have people fellowship with us and worship. It's always a joy to get to worship the Lord in spirit and truth. Our first announcement is the most important. God loves you so much that he sent his son to live and die for you. The Bible tells us in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent his son to save us because we were lost. We were sinners in need of a savior, and the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he hath made him to be sin for us. He knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Christ took and paid for our sins on the cross. He defeated sin in the grave and in his resurrection, and now we must believe in him for salvation. Hey, Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. And Jesus invites you to put your faith in him. He is metaphorically standing at the door of your heart knocking. If you will open the door, he will come. Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him. Please trust Jesus today. It will be the greatest decision you've ever made, I promise you. Second announcement is please share this video to our online audience. Please share a video, start a watch party. We want to get the gospel out to as many people as possible. And our last announcement is we have a special. Our very own Tamara is going to sing a special this morning.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turned his as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there, that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my
such a beautiful, intimate song. Just a good father would relentlessly do anything that it takes to be with his child. Our God has this relentless love for us. Amen. Sing with me. Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. So, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, relentless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves and I deny. Well, I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve.
Oh, the chase is me down, fight till I
shadow, you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up. Coming after you. There's no wall you won't kick down. Lie you won't tear down. Coming after me. No, it's not. There's no shadow you won't light up. Mountain, you won't climb up. Come to a close of our time at worship, I'd like to spend some time and really focus on opening our hearts and just giving thanks for our blessings that we have and that are yet to come. We serve a God that loves us so much he sent his son to Calvary. The son Jesus Christ sacrificed and his resurrection gives us a living hope. Sing this last song with me.
Chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven, spoke your name into the darkness. Your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living. Hallelujah. promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on you.
Sing that again.
Let's go back to that third verse. It says, then came the morning. Go back to that third verse. Let me see it. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Get this. His buried body began to breathe. And then it says, out of the silence, the roaring lion declared. And this is the great news. The grave no longer has claim on us, ladies and gentlemen. Jesus has set us free. His is the victory. Let's sing this last verse one more time and all the way through to the end of the song. Sing it out.
Then came the morning, it sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared.
Morning. Man, you may be seated. Jesus Christ is our living hope. Golly, I love that song. What a powerful, powerful, powerful song. Thank you, Jacob. Thank you, praise team, for leading us in that this morning. Man, I could go for another dose of that. He is indeed our living hope. What a What a blessed thing. Hey, we're going to be finishing up our series on love this evening. Hopefully you've been in with us. We started Wednesday a week ago, okay? So a week from last Wednesday is where we started and talked about love. And then we, last Sunday morning, we talked about Ephesus and how they had lost their first love and talked about the importance of Jesus Christ and loving him. And then hopefully if you tuned in Wednesday night, we talked about right out of John chapter 13, verse 35, where Jesus is talking to the disciples. It's right there at the very end, right before he's going to go to the cross. He's going to go to the cross the next morning. They're about to go to the garden. He's about to be arrested. It's the Last Supper. Judas already left. He's given his disciples some final information because he knows he doesn't have much time before he is going to be crucified. Certainly he knows he'll spend a few more days with them after the resurrection. But this is some of the very final instruction they get. He says, this is how they will know you're my disciple. Okay, he said, this is how they're going to know you're following me. Listen, you know if you're saved, you're a disciple of Jesus Christ. Now look, the apostolic age lasted for one generation. We're not apostles. There are no apostles left in the world. If somebody tells you they're an apostle, you can just kind of snicker under your breath at them, okay? We're not apostles, but we are disciples. What is a disciple of Jesus Christ? It is a follower of Jesus Christ. That's all a disciple is. That's why we call it discipleship, when we teach people to follow after Jesus Christ, because we are disciples. He said, this is how they're going to know you're my disciple. This is how they're going to know you're my follower, if you have love. That's what he said. He said, if you have love. He said, if you have love, that's going to be the chief evidence that they know you are following me. He said, and especially if you have it one for another. That's John chapter 13, verse 35. So today we're going to talk and we're going to finish up this four-part series on love, unless God just really pushes me to do another one, which at this time I do not anticipate, okay? I anticipate this being the very last one. 1 Timothy this morning, chapter 1, verses 3 through 5 is where we're going to start. I've entitled this sermon, Real Deal Love. Real Deal Love. And this one is the hardest of the sermons to preach. I've really had to, I mean, I don't know if you can see from out there, but you see, like, I type these notes out. Do you see all the black marks all over that? That's all the extra thoughts that keep popping in my head that I'm like, you need to say that so you can help explain what you're trying to say. You ever have something in your mind and you desperately want to get it out and communicate it, but you're just not quite sure how to? Welcome to the church this morning, okay? That's kind of where I feel like I'm at. So real deal love. We're going to look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. I feel like this is an appropriate way to end because if you remember John in chapter 13, verse 35, he was writing back to the church at Ephesus. It was the first of the seven churches that the messenger, the angels were talking to. And he's writing to this church at Ephesus some 50 years, 45 to 50 years after Paul had started it, correct? Well, this letter, 1 Timothy, is a letter from Paul to his preacher boy Timothy. Does anybody know what Timothy was doing at the time that Paul writes this letter to Timothy? Well, if you don't know, he was the pastor at Ephesus. So he's pastoring the church at Ephesus when Paul writes this letter to him and says, listen, there's something that I really need you to instill in these people. You see, 50 years before that letter was written by or through John, from Jesus through John, Paul knew this church needed love. He knew that they needed the real deal. He knew that if they were truly going to reach out, if they were truly going to be Jesus' disciples, if they were truly going to be what Christ had called them to be, they're going to need love. And so as Paul is writing to Timothy, the very last two books, Paul writes 13, potentially 14 books of the New Testament. The very last two books that he would write would be 1 Timothy, and certainly his last book was 2 Timothy. So he's writing to his preacher boy. He's writing to this young man that he has been mentoring and training. We know he had a few preacher boys, Timothy, Titus, and Titus didn't need quite the instruction Timothy did. Titus was seasoned. He was aged. He was a troubleshooter. But Timothy was very blessed. He was a great young man. He was a great pastor. But Paul intentionally poured a little more into him, right? And so he is giving him this final instruction before he departs. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 1. We're going to start in verse 3. It says, as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia. So again, see here, he's at Ephesus. That thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions, rather than godly edifying, which is in faith, so do. Listen to this. Now, the end of the commandment is charity. OK, Okay, anytime you see the word charity in the King James Bible, it is referring to love. So you could substitute the word love in there if you chose to. You would say, now the end of the commandment is love. Your Bible will say charity, out of a pure heart, out of good conscience, and out of faith unfeigned. So he said, and out of true faith, not the fake stuff, right? So he says, love. It's love out of a pure heart. So this is the last sermon on love. And as we talk about love, please understand, obviously we are not talking about romantic love. Love has taken on so many, I would even call misnomers today, that there's so many things that we use the word love for that don't really equate to what love is. And so as we talk about love, certainly we aren't talking about romantic love. We're not talking about what the world would view as love. I'm talking about Christian love as compared to religion. You know, if we're not careful, especially as a church, we'll find ourselves falling into religion. That's not what Jesus didn't call us to religion. Jesus called us to follow him, and he called us to love. And so I'm talking about Christian love as compared to religion. And love, you're going to find, is the chief evidence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. When we get in the book of Galatians, also written by Paul, we get into chapter 5, verse 22, he's giving these fruits of the Spirit. Paul is saying, listen, if the Spirit indwells in you and you are truly a follower of Jesus, here are some evidences, here are some fruit that you should see. And the very first one, look at this, but this is the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is, what's that very first word? What's that very first word? It's love. The chief evidence of the Holy Spirit in our lives should be love. So in verses 3 and 4, Paul instructs Timothy to confront those in the church at Ephesus who are adding to the gospel. I'm telling you, there is so much danger in adding to or taking away from the gospel of Jesus Christ. I cannot overemphasize the importance of not doing that. This is not the only time in Scripture we see Paul saying and rebuking those who would add to the gospel. He spent an entire book, the book of Galatians, was all about those Judaizers who were adding to the gospel. So in verse 3 and 4, Paul instructs Timothy to confront those in the church at Ephesus who were adding to the gospel. You know, like almost everyone, we are tempted to codify our Christianity. What do I mean by that? We are tempted to standardize or to systematize our Christianity. We're just tempted to standardize things. We are comfortable with identifiable limits and rules, aren't we? And so we tend to say, if you're a Christian, you go to church. If you're a Christian, you tithe. If you're a Christian, you will do X, you'll do Y, you'll do Z. And what we do is we make ourselves a holy checklist, if you will. And if we're a Christian, we will do these things. And this is what will give evidence to the world that we are Christians, because after all, I go to church. After all, I give to the church. After all, I don't steal, I don't lie, I don't chew, and I don't hang with those who do. I am being the person that I'm supposed to be. So obviously, I'm a Christian. But hopefully you understand that we have churches that are full of people who have no idea who Jesus is or what Christianity is actually about. And so we have this whole entire checklist, and we feel like if we are doing these things and we systematize and we codify and we standardize our lives so that we can become comfortable and identified as a follower of Jesus. And you know, honestly, this warning was good for Timothy too. Paul's telling Timothy, and he's telling him to communicate to the church at Ephesus, don't let this happen. You know, this is a real danger for pastors. It really is. This is a chief danger for pastors. And that's why Paul is writing to Timothy and saying, look, this isn't just going to be a struggle for the people at Ephesus. This is going to be a struggle for you. You're going to be tempted to just systematize your life so that it seems that you are following Christ the way you should. Then in verse 5, Paul moves into the heart of Christian faith. He moves into the heart of how Christian faith is lived out. He moves into the heart of how it is meant to be lived. Listen, the true heart of our lives, are you with me? Are you with me? Okay, hey, if you're ready to hear from God this morning, say, bring it. Okay, the true heart of our lives is to be love. It's to be love. You know, just last week we saw that 45 years later, the writer of Revelation pointed out that love was the church's problem. What had they done? They'd lost. They were doing some great things. They were following doctrine. They'd really done well with this whole codify, systematize, standardize thing. But they'd lost the love. And Jesus said, I have a complaint against you. He said, you've done well here. You know, because these things that we systematize and codify, they're good things. It's not a bad thing to be somebody who goes to church, somebody who gives to church, somebody who doesn't steal, lie, chew, or hang with those who do. Those are good things. But they're not the chief thing. And Jesus' complaint with the church at Ephesus was they'd lost the chief thing. They'd lost love. So let's talk about this major issue this morning. The purpose, you need to see it. Here's my first point. The whole entire purpose of this is love. That's the entire purpose. Love is at the center of who and what we are as Christians. Our spiritual and eventual physical rescue germinated in God's love for us. Do you understand that? Our spiritual rescue happened because God loves us. Our physical rescue, when we are released from this body or when Jesus Christ comes back in the rapture to call us to himself, will happen because of love. As a matter of fact, he loved us, God, that he sent his son to die for us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You see, God didn't send his son because he had somehow obligated himself. You ever done that? You ever accidentally obligated yourself? Or not even accidentally, maybe you purposely obligated yourself because something was way in the future. A pastor friend I know, his name was, honestly, his name's not important. I could tell you his name, but it's really not important. My dad was playing golf with him one day, and he had actually just gotten back from a Hawaiian vacation. And it was a really neat deal. It was a Hawaiian cruise where they would get on the boat every night and go to sleep, and the boat would take them to the next island. When they woke up, they were there at that island, and they'd get out and they'd do whatever that island had to offer. They'd come back, get on the boat, go to sleep, and the next day they woke up, they're at the next island, they'd get out and do whatever, you know, and as he's telling, this trip they'd taken, my dad said, man, that sounds wonderful. He said, that just sounds so fun. He said, how much did that cost you? And you got to know this pastor, I'm not going to say his name, but this pastor could make Abe Lincoln say hello. He could pinch a penny, you know what I mean? And so he said, Lindell, I got to be honest with you. It was really, really, really expensive. He said, on my 25th anniversary, my wife looked at me and said, honey, wouldn't it be great if on our 40th anniversary we could take a Hawaiian cruise? And this pastor looked at my dad and he said, you know what? You'll promise anything when it's 15 years away. He said, and as we kept getting closer, I kept hoping she'd forget about it. But sure enough, on our 40th anniversary, she said, so are we going? And he's like, at that point, I didn't have a choice. So he unforked it and he went. You know, we're funny about that, right? We are willing to do anything if it's a year away. We are willing to obligate ourselves if it's in the future, right? That's not what happened with God. God so loved us. He was so moved by love for us as a pitiful creation that he sent his only son. And he didn't just send him. That in itself was a huge deal. Losing his son, seeing his son go to heaven and lower himself and debase himself to the point he becomes human. That in itself is a huge sacrifice and really a humiliation. That's why the Bible says he humbled himself. But he didn't just have him do that. He had him die. Not just die, but a wicked, vile, horrible death for us. Where did that germinate from? Love. And his son loved us so much that he did die for us. Romans 5:8 said, but God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, what did it say Christ did? It says Christ died for us. He chose to give his life. Listen, nobody took Jesus' life from him. He was God. Imagine what he could have done had he chose to. But instead, in innocence, he willingly gave his life for us. And when we are born again, his spirit puts a heart of love into us. Look at 1 John chapter 4, 19. It says, we love him. Why? Because he first loved us. So this whole entire thing, our spiritual and eventual physical rescue, it all germinated in God's love for us. So when we are born again, his spirit puts a heart of love into us, and that heart loves the God who saved us. And that love should love the brethren who are saved with us. And that love should love those who still need to be saved. This is missions, right? This is outreach. This is letting God's love be so strong in our hearts and lives that we are willing to give that other people can hear the message that we could never go to, but that desperately need to hear that Jesus loved them so much that he died for them. So we give and people go. Why does that happen? It doesn't happen because of a systematic list of rules. It doesn't happen because of standardized or codified rules in our life. It happens because somebody is so moved by the love of God that they go. So let's talk about this love. What is it? Now listen, I know when we talk about love in the Bible, a lot of times we talk about phileo love, or we talk about eros love, or agape love, and the, you know, the 3 to 4 Greek words that we find for love in Scripture. But I want us to look at it in a little different way this morning. First of all, I want you to see natural love. All of us are born with a natural love. We might call this the because love, right? We're born with it. Even the worst of us are born with this love. We love our mother, right? Because, why? She loved us. She took care of us. You go into the prisons and you find the worst of the worst, and they usually still love mommy, right? They'll have that I love mom tattoo across their chest or something. Why? This is a natural love. This is a love that we are born with. And by nature, this love changes with ideas. We're going to love different things because those things appeal to us, or because those things in some way we feel like will satisfy us. And so we call this natural love. And then the second one we see in Scripture is what we would refer to as legal love, right? This is the law of Moses type of love. This is where we love somebody because we've been told to. That's the law, and that's what you do. The law of Moses in Leviticus said, you're to love your neighbor as yourself. He repeated it again in Deuteronomy. You're to love your neighbor as yourself. So we love our neighbor, and we do it because the Bible says we need to. The Bible says we're supposed to. That is the legal love, right? I will love you like myself. I can only do it with training, but I will love you like myself as I train myself to do so. And then we have what's referred to as supernatural love. Supernatural love, which says, I'll love you sacrificially, which says, I'll love you like Jesus loved me. That said, I'll love you even though you're not lovable. I'll love you even though I have nothing to gain by loving you. I'll love you because Jesus loves me, and so I love you. This third love, this supernatural love, only comes from God. You hear me? This only comes from God. You can't be taught this love. It's not natural. It's not a because of love. This is a love that can only come from God. Because this is not a love that rewards you. This is not a love that is beneficial to you. This is a love that you have for no other reason than it was supernaturally given to you. So, as Paul is explaining this love principle in 1 Timothy, he explains the substitution. You see, Paul was fighting, and he wanted Timothy to fight that the Christian community, when they are, let me rephrase it this way. Let me ask you a question before I get into it, because I'm going to get ahead of myself if I'm not careful. What does a Christian community do when they are not seeing supernatural love as a normal thing among them? What do we do? What do we tend to do? What do you do when you're not seeing that supernatural love? What they do is they look for other evidences of spirituality. Okay? This is where this codifying, systematizing, standardizing thing comes from. When they're not seeing that love, they create this list of rules and they create this list of identifiers so that at some point they can look at themselves or they can look at another and say, we are spiritual people. Just look. I tithe. I go to church 3 times a week. I read my Bible. I pray. I have these list of rules that I'm following. So look, I am a spiritual person. And the opposite is true too, right? They want to be able to point at another one and say, look, he is not a spiritual person. Just look. He doesn't adhere to these rules. He doesn't do the things that he is supposed to do. And Paul was fighting against this, and he wanted Timothy to fight against this. Paul didn't want that to become the standard. You know, growing up, and of course, I'm a pastor's kid. Most of you know that. My dad's a pastor, and he would tell you this because it was the way he was trained. I grew up seeing this, you know, we were spiritual because we adhered to the rules thing. That's what we grew up in. We're spiritual because we use the right translation of the Bible. We're spiritual because I wear a suit and tie to church. We're spiritual because fill in the blank, right? And I can remember because I was 13 or so when this thing really started changing in my dad. My dad graduated Arlington Baptist College, graduated in 1981, went and started a church in League City, Texas. That's just south of Houston on 45. In 1993, he left that church and was called to Tabernacle Baptist Church in Crane, Texas. That's south of Midland, Odessa, in the middle of nowhere. Went from a city of about 3 million to a town of 3,000. And he decided to go back to school. And so Dad started attending seminary. His parents, you know, couldn't help him when he went to college. And, you know, they had retired and they told him, you know, we couldn't help you when you go to college. But if you wanted to go on and do another degree, we'd be glad to pay for it. So Dad said, you know, okay, yeah, that'd be great. I'll go do that. Dad ended up in the Moody Theological Seminary. And I remember Dad telling the story. He said that, you know, the first time he shows up, he's in a suit and he's in a tie. And he doesn't know what to expect. He'd never been to seminary before. And he's sitting down. And he said the person right in front of him has hair down to his shoulders and an earring in his ear and tattoos on his arm. And he said, I didn't realize this was a school for pirates. And he was like, this guy wasn't following the rules, right? He wasn't adhering to the rules. This wasn't right. This guy wasn't doing what he was supposed to do. And Dad said as he was processing through the week and as he was processing through weeks to come, he started seeing that God was doing amazing things in and through these people and that they were seeing amazing things in their churches that he wasn't seeing. And he said he finally one day just blurted it out loud as he's in a conversation with Mom. He said, all I can figure is that these rules don't matter as much to God as they do to me. He said, because God is working in their lives in a way that I'm not seeing. He said, it was almost at that moment of epiphany that he realized, you know, I think God's a lot more concerned with my heart than he is with my rules. And the truth is, he is. God is so much more concerned with your heart and with your love than he is with your rules. You see, good intentions evolve into false teaching. None of those rules are bad. They're never bad by nature. As a matter of fact, if you follow those rules, it's not a bad thing. But if you look at yourself and you say, I'm a Christian because I follow those rules, then you're going into false teaching. You're following the same road the Judaizers followed, right? It's like, yeah, you can be a Christian, but then you also need to be circumcised. You also need to make sure you follow all the Jewish principles and spiritual days, and you need to make sure that you're sacrificing. And that's not it. As a matter of fact, Paul was livid in the book of Galatians because that was happening. That's not what God called us to. He called us to a heart of love. And let me tell you what happens when you come to Jesus Christ and that heart starts to change. Suddenly these things that we have listed as rules to be spiritual start to appear in your life, not because you're following the rules, but because God has changed your heart. And you want to do these things. And you don't do them so that you can appear to be Christian. You do them because that's what you do. God has just moved your heart in that way. So sometimes the standards are biblical. But the adherence is external and not internal. That's the problem. Again, don't get me wrong. Don't walk out of here saying, well, Lindell said the rules are wrong and we shouldn't do it. That's not what I said. These rules are good, and most of those rules are biblical, and they're good things to follow. You should come to church. You should read your Bible. You should tithe. You should give to missions. You should do these things. But they shouldn't be external. They shouldn't be happening so that people can notice and or identify you as a Christian. They should be happening because they're internal, because God has changed your heart, and because of love you choose to do these things. Man, I hope you're seeing the difference. This is the muddy water I was hoping to push through. You see, if we let it become external and not internal, we end up where the church at Ephesus ended up in Revelation. We end up losing our first love. So here's the test. Notice the emphasis in verse 5 on being genuine. Verse 5 says, now the end of the commandment is charity, right? Love out of a pure heart and of good conscience and of faith unfeigned. So here's the test on being genuine. He says, do you love from a pure heart? He says, is this real? Is it a real thing? Are you loving because you were told to? Or are you loving because you have that supernatural love that has been placed inside you that cannot be bottled, that cannot be contained, and is flooding outside of you? That pure, real heart of love that you have with a good conscience and a sincere faith. It's the real deal. Man, no one likes or wants a put-on insincere love. And honestly, it's usually pretty easy to spot. And people can sniff it out real quick. Nobody wants a smarmy, salesman-like, not quite skin-deep love. That love will show itself, especially given time. So, what makes this kind of love real as opposed to put on? The love works itself out of us, not into us. Did you get it? Let me say it again. This love works itself out of us, not into us. It's not something we can be trained to do. It's something that happens because God has transformed us on the inside. It's a love that works out of us. It's something that God gives us. It's something that people can see. It is loving unlovable people. Anybody in here know an unlovable person? Don't tell me who the person is, but do you know an unlovable person? Quit pointing. No, I'm joking. Nobody was pointing. Anybody know an unlovable person? This is a love that loves unlovable people. Because we're unlovable people. And Jesus loved us. This is a love that is loving in a sacrificial way. And that love that Jesus had was supernatural. You want to talk about a sacrifice? It is loving when one is not loved back. It's not a love that anticipates love coming back to us. It's a love that loves without expecting credit. It's a love that loves without expecting thanks. Well, you don't know what I did for them. They didn't even say thank you. Well, you obviously did it for the wrong reason. Certainly you didn't do it so they'd tell you thank you. If you did, are you codifying? Are you systematizing? Are you standardizing? Are you external? Listen, this is loving without pay. It is behaving in a loving manner. When this kind of love is present, rules are not needed. When it is not, rules are most definitely needed. Listen, this kind of love produces all kinds of byproducts. Where this love is, you're going to find unity. You know what Christianity and what every church needs right now? Unity. You know, as Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, what's the first thing he points out to them? You got a lot of things going on, but you're completely ununified. And he starts working through all these things that they need to unify themselves with, and then he gets to chapter 13, and what does he do? He spends that entire chapter saying, it's about love. He said, oh, look, we got faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. So where there is love, there is unity. Where love is, there is mutual patience. Where love is, there is spiritual liberty. praise the Lord for spiritual liberty. Where love is, the Spirit is active. Whew. Man, don't you love to be in a place where the Spirit of God is active? Man, we could go on and on and on and on. So I ask you, how are you doing on this issue? Do you need your life systematized, standardized, codified because of your lack of love? Because you're afraid that lack of love will otherwise lead you the wrong way? You know, I told you when this kind of love is present, rules aren't needed. You know, when you really love somebody, you're not going to steal from them. If I really love somebody, I'm not going to lie to them. If I really love somebody, I'm not going to hurt them. If I, you know, I love my wife. And you know what? Somebody doesn't have to tell me, Lindell, make sure and don't cheat on your wife. I wouldn't want to because I love her. Where this love is present, rules are not necessary. But where this love isn't present, which is this entire world, right? Rules are necessary. So I ask you, do you need your life codified because your lack of love will otherwise lead you the wrong way? Listen, this kind of love is not natural. You can't work it up in your own life. You can't train yourself to do it. Only God can give it. You hear me? Only God can give it, and we should seek it diligently. You know, in Revelation 2, Jesus told this church, the Ephesus church, to return to this love. Listen to me. That is one of the most beautiful statements you'll ever hear. Because in that very statement where he says, return to this love, what is Jesus saying? He is saying this love can be recaptured. But it can only be recaptured through Jesus Christ and the blessed Holy Spirit, that great triune God, the great three in one. As our praise team comes up, if you'd stand with me. This love can be recaptured. Would you search your heart? Would you search your life, Christian? Would you think through this? Would you say that this love is truly what identifies you? Or are you being identified by external things? Listen, this is an internal thing. This is a God-only type of love. This is that 1 John 4:19 love, that we love him because he first loved us. Love. A love that we could not possibly get on our own. You know, if we really want to be identified as disciples of Jesus Christ, John chapter 13, verse 35 says that this is how they will know you're my disciples, that you love one another. So, Christian, how you doing on that? Let me speak to the lost for a minute. Angie, go ahead and start. You know, the most important love that you can capture is the love of God for you. When I say I'm talking to the lost, I mean I'm talking to the person that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Savior. If you don't know him, you're lost. And your eternity is way troublesome. John 3:16 that says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Is that good news? 1 John 4:10 says, herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. We're sinners. We're in desperate need. The Bible says in Romans 5:8 that God loved us so much, right? But it says, but God commendeth his love. He showed his love to us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's a pretty incredible statement when you realize we really aren't lovable. I mean, the Bible's very clear we aren't lovable. It says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. It's Romans 6:23. It said the wages of that sin is death. We're not lovable. But notice what John said in 1 John 3:1. He says, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God, the children of God. Even though we aren't lovable, he loved us. It can only be done through a supernatural love. Wow. get that. We have the opportunity to be the child of God because of his love. So how do we do that? Ephesians 2, 8, 9 says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. How do you do it? You do it by putting your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. When you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, he does a complete makeover. You ever seen that show, Extreme Home Makeover? I don't think it's even on anymore, but they used to go in and just completely renovate a place. You want to talk about extreme makeover. When Jesus comes in, he casts out the old and makes all things new. 1 Corinthians 5:21 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a 5:17, excuse me, says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. All things become new. That could be you. So if you don't know Jesus, come to know Jesus. If you do know Jesus, where's your love? How you loving? He has demonstrated amazing love to us. How are we demonstrating our love to others? I'm going to sing a great song. As we sing this song, it's Amazing Love. Would you come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior? That's the number one thing. If you don't know him, please reach out to me online. Reach out to me via Facebook Messenger. So many ways you can reach out to me. Email. But here, if you don't know Jesus, please, please just come talk to me. We can stand 6 feet apart and hear each other. Let's talk. Christian, would you spend a minute right now? Would you just turn around, get on your knees in front of your chair, and would you just spend some time with God saying, God, I want to love. I want to be the real deal. I want to have some real deal love. I don't want to love because it's an external thing. God, help it to be an internal thing. Help me to be moved to love in ways that I didn't think possible because you loved me in ways that shouldn't have been possible, but that were because of you. That's amazing love. It's possible through him. The song says, I'm forgiven. Sing it out.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. The Spirit is within me.
You are my king, Jesus. You are my king,
out that side door if you'd like, or the very back if you'd like, whichever way. Front two rows, you can head out this front door here.
Praise the Lord, I know it's true.
Front few rows, I think.
It's my joy to honor.
In the middle, if you'll give them just a second, I'll dismiss you and we can keep from clustering as we head out.
I honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do.
Like to go front, back, wherever, you can head out this time.